Patrick Wedge. Patrick's our he saves us. His name is last in the credits because they usually say the most important thing for last.
Like the director in the
the director's usually first.
No, yeah. at the beginning credits, he's always...
Start the credit.
Yeah. Oh, yes, that's true. I'm just going to be quiet. Go ahead. You run the panel. Amanda's going to run the panel right now.
No, you talk.
Amanda, you hear any good jokes lately?
I did. I have a funny joke. I have a... it's topical, too. Okay. So, there's a dad shark and a son shark. Uh-oh, it turned off. Oh, no, I'm taking it off. Wait, hold on.
That's all right.
Oh, okay.
We're not cursing at the audience. Okay.
There is, actually, I'll use the PG word instead. Okay. So there's a dad shark and a son shark, and dad has taken the shark out for hunting lessons, and so he says to the kid shark, he says, "Okay, son, today we're going to learn how to hunt humans." Okay, dad, let's learn how to do that. So dad shark. Okay, see that beach over there, all those humans over there? I need you to pick one. Go up to that human. Rise up to the surface so that your fin sticks out. Circle them two or three times, and then grab them. And the little shark is like, okay, Dad, but why don't we just, you know, go from underneath and grab them from there? And Dad says, well, because they taste a whole lot better without pooping them.
As explained to Amanda, you have to tell a joke like 40 times before you perfect it. I don't know if you noticed that. Like, people who can't tell jokes can tell the greatest joke, and you just sit there and look at them like, all right, whatever. But then you got somebody who knows how to tell a joke like amazingly, and it's a horrible joke, and you're still laughing at it.
That's what you are. You're a very amazing person.
Comedy's tough.
Yeah, comedy's tough.
And which brings us to Harley Quinn. It's funny because when we started Harley Quinn, we just thought she was a fun character. Well, you guys know from the animation and everything.
She's supposed to be fun.
Supposed to be fun. And when we got the assignment for Harley, we just said, well, we're going to make it a fun comic. And then it took off and did very well. And Dan DiDio at DC said, can you maybe you and Amanda teach some classes on how to write humor to other writers? And I said, they're either funny or they're not funny. I don't know how to teach. How do you teach somebody to be funny? I mean, you can push them down a flight of stairs and it's funny, right? But I don't know if it's them being funny or the actual thing. Yeah, and then if they snap their neck and die, it's not funny, right? There's like a whole bunch of things. So humor is tough. Writing dark comics for me is easy. Because it's like you just go.
I think humor is sort of instinctual.
You think so?
I think so. I mean, I think it can be taught to a certain extent, but for the most part, you have to have the instinct for it.
I mean, do people, you guys, you laugh, show of hands, who laughs at things that other people don't laugh at? So you like the people in a movie theater laughing when everyone's quiet, right? You ever do that? And everybody's like, people are like, what's wrong with you? Hey, Schindler's List. It's kind of, you know, if you look at it from a different point of view. What was that, the Seinfeld with the, when they were making out?
Because his parents were staying with him, and he had no privacy, so they had to go to the movies to make out. So the movie they chose to go see was Schindler's List.
Right, Jerry's making out with the girl, and they're like, Uncle Leo making out during Schindler's List. Yeah, I mean, you know, so that's funny.
Pikachu, that was even worse.
Right, well, Uncle Leo.
Seinfeld.
Seinfeld. It's horrible.
And his mother was so ashamed. His mother was just,
what are we talking about? Oh, yes, Harley Quinn.
Humor.
Oh, so we have some slides, I guess.
Yeah, right?
All right.
Pictures.
Should I turn down the lights? I can turn down the lights. I got it.
So if anybody doesn't know, we're going to start with Amanda Connor. Most people know you. She's been drawn for how long? Good Lord.
Since I was three.
Well,
it helps having both parents being artists and having art supplies all over the house. That makes learning how to draw a lot easier. But it doesn't help when you off with your parents' art supplies and they come into your bedroom yelling, "Where are my markers?" So that's sort of how that all began.
I have a question. No, I'm kidding.
Yes. So yeah, I started drawing at a young age, but I didn't start professionally, like doing comics professionally, until 1988, the fall of 1988, which will make this 30 years I've been doing comics professionally.
And you being 34, it makes like 2 years, 4 years.
Yeah, I started it.
Right away.
I have to go home with her, folks.
Georgia O'Keeffe, or perhaps, cosplaying as a comic book person.
As a man.
or like Marie Cassatt, like a famous painter, but I was like, I want to do comic books. And my dad was like, yes. Because my dad had wanted to do comics when he was a kid, but his parents discouraged him from doing that because that's what parents in the 50s did. They discouraged kids from going into art and comic, especially comics. So
it was no money in comics. I mean,
no,
back then.
No.
You did it out of the love of comics.
It was a labor of love. So he went into advertising and made a lot more money, but I think comics would have been a lot more satisfying. He actually knows how to do a comic book style. He's good, my dad's good.
Yeah, show me.
Yeah.
Her dad loves Mad Magazine.
Yeah.
So that's his like favorite thing.
In fact, when he was young, he was doing a bunch of, who's the guy that did all the crazy faces?
Basil Wolverton.
Basil Wolverton. My dad was really into Basil Wolverton and started doing like Basil Wolverton type drawings.
Jack
Davis too, but he was like, and he had his Basil Wolverton period when he was like maybe 13. And my granny Nan sent him to a psychiatrist. So that's how this all came about. An encouraging dad.
It's great.
And a lot of art supplies.
And then we have Jimmy Palmiotti, so most of you probably know by now who he is.
Right.
Tell us a little about yourself.
I am born and raised in Brooklyn, New York. If you can't hear the accent, it's there. It's not going anywhere. It's permanent residence in his body.
And Italian.
And Italian. Yes. What about it? Get something against Italians. It's not safe in Florida. It's not safe in Florida if you don't like Italians. There's little villages of Italians everywhere. You have to watch out. Born and raised in Brooklyn. My brothers, my younger brother Pete is in comics too. He's an inker and sometimes artist. And went to the High School of Art and Design with guys like Joe Jesko and Dennis Cowan and my good buddy Mark Texera. We went to high school together. If you know Mark and imagine us as kids in high school running around. we went to high school in Manhattan. So we were at 57th Street and 2nd Avenue. So that's when Times Square was a filthy, horrible place.
Yep.
And what's that show on HBO that...
The Deuce.
It was exactly that when I was a kid. I used to walk down the street and girls used to go, "Hey, you want a date?" And I was like, "Date? No, I just want to go to your room. I don't want to go on a date." So we grew up in Manhattan, and I took comic art. The first job I ever got in comics was in 10th grade. A guy named Chick Stone, who was a very famous inker over Jack Kirby, went to my teacher and said, "I need a kid to do some backgrounds. You know, I only want to pay him nothing or next to nothing." And that's where they would get students from. And Chick Stone, they gave me an address to go to. The teacher said, "Well, you're the only one here that can kind of hold a brush. So go to this guy's house in Queens, and he'll give you some comic work to do." And I went, took a subway to Queens, and walked up to this house, and there's this older gentleman. He must have been in his 70s or maybe, you know, when you're a kid, you think everyone's in their 90s, right? And they're like old people, they're almost dead. Like everyone's almost dead. Meanwhile, now I'm like, oh wait, he was only 51, you know? But I went in there and he was like, it smelled like a cigarette's ass. And he was sitting there, you know, inking away, and he gives me a page of Inhumans, this comic The Inhumans, which is a human torch in Captain America during World War II. And he says, okay, take this page and draw me, I need the first panel, I need where all the trains are stored, like the sub, like the trains. And draw, pencil and ink that out, a train yard, yeah. Draw that out, come back tomorrow, let me see what you can do. So I took a train all the way to Coney Island where they have the actual train yards, and I climbed the fence and sat there and I drew the train yards and inked it. I thought it was great. And I thought, I got this job, you know? And I went back to Queens the next day, and he looked at it, and he goes, what is this, a photo? And I'm like, well, I drew the train yards. He's like, yeah, here's $5, take care. So that was my first job in comics. I got fired overnight. And it was a one-night gig.
So why did he fire you if you did a perfect job?
Because it was too perfect. It looked like a photo where he had these really animated-looking figures. It didn't make any sense to him. And I get it now. I actually look at it in Invaders 41, I look at the panel now and I go, oh yeah, he just simplified it. He went in and threw some white out over it. And so that was discouraging for a 10th grader. And eventually, by 12th grade, I started inking books under other people's names. So there was, I'm not gonna give away who they are, but there was a certain amount of artists in New York that were inkers and artists that took way too much drugs, and they would sleep all day and never get anything done. And they saw this kid from high school who was willing to work, work, work. I want to get in comics. So I did a lot of their work, and I inked some books like Howard the Duck. I inked some sci-fi stuff at DC, some Marvel comics like pages, backgrounds, pages, figures. And I realized that the guys I was working for were named guys back then. And this will give you an idea how old I am. That was 1978 and 79. And I realized, I took a look around, and they lived in a one-bedroom apartment in Manhattan. And they had their mattresses standing up against the wall, so at night they would just pull them down, boom, 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 and the three of them would sleep there. So these were three guys working in comics, living, grown men, living in one apartment. Again, it smelled like a cigarette's ass, because back then everybody smoked. And they couldn't even pay the rent to get a bedroom or a two-bedroom apartment. I realized that comics are not for me. I'm not going to live like this. And so I went into advertising, and I did very well in advertising until I turned 30. And then I said, okay, now I think I know I can make a living in comics. Like, now I think I figured it out how to make money and do this. And I found my buddy Mark Texera, who was penciling and inking Punisher and Ghost Rider for Marvel. That's some of the best stuff, actually. And he needed help with backgrounds. And I said, yeah, let me help you. And after work, I would go there and work up in the Marvel offices. And then I would show my work around. And that's eventually how I got work at Marvel. And before I'm writing, because most people know me as a writer now, but before that, I must have inked around 1,000 comic books. If you look up my name on comics, if you have a collection and start looking through it, eventually you'll find a book that I inked, if it was from the 90s or the 2000s.
I was
doing three books a month at some point, maybe four, and then covers, and that's actually how I met Amanda.
Yeah.
I got an ink job, and they
said,
Gargoyles. Yeah, for Gargoyles, a Disney Gargoyles comic, and that's how we met. And she kept hitting on me, and I eventually gave her. That's what you guys think this panel's about, but we're just going to talk. We're going to take questions, because who's been to one of our panels before? I know a couple of you. You know how random it is. So, so this is our company, Paper Films, and these are the services we do. Do we do most of these, Patrick?
Yeah.
We do all of them. I'm not going to read them out. You guys have eyes.
Really,
the blind guy back there.
Yeah, really,
I'm making you all look.
But. Yeah, it's comics, you know, screenwriting. They do both, you know, movies, TV.
They just finished shooting a movie. I did a book with.
We go through current projects.
He's on the ball. I like Patrick. Despite of his hate for Italians. Go ahead.
Jeez. If I was only Jewish. Yeah, so right now, the DC Giant, the 100-page special that's at Walmart. Anybody's getting that right now?
Anybody find these books? Did anybody find you? Did one person?
Wow.
Did anybody know they're not out there? Some of you guys that know? Or you just don't care? For me, okay. Most you don't care.
I haven't found.
And he doesn't care. He doesn't. He's like, I don't give a shit. Oh, you have some. All right, everybody. He's giving away free ones up here later. You're wrestling for them, but they're free.
The target.
Well, the thing with these Walmart books is I did the first two Batman, I did the first two Supermans, then they got some hacks to write them after me. And then we took over the Wonder Woman one with issue three of the JLA book.
Yeah.
But the goal, how it was presented to us, is we're going to work on comics that that are going to be for a new audience. So people that never read comics before are going to buy these. So the key to us writing these was that they should be simple from the ground up. So with Wonder Woman, make believe you never knew who Batman was. And so if you pick up this comic with the story I did, you're going to get who Batman is in 12 pages. You know, so that was the goal with these. And as you guys know, it's like it's hard to get people to read comics. They either love them or they don't. Or they go, oh, I don't read comic books. Like they say it like that. I don't read comic books. But I see every movie and I buy every toy and I have a million Funkos with every character, but I don't read the comic books. So the industry, and I don't know if you noticed, the other thing is a lot of comic stores are closing. And if you're not aware of that, in the past month, I think we've lost 12 stores in the United States. That's a lot, because there's only like 3,000 total. And it's a pretty big country.
But you said that even like last summer, or maybe last spring, 50 closed.
Yeah, 50 stores closed, yeah. That's a lot. That's a lot of stores. Now, granted, a percentage of them are people who never should have a store in the first place. I used to call them high on your own supply people who love comics so much that they don't even want to sell them in the store because that's their favorite issue. I don't know if you run into that. Or the guy that owns the store that says, you don't want to buy that. That's a terrible book. You know, it's like me going to Publix and the guy goes, you don't like watermelon. No, I do like watermelon. No, you don't want to buy that watermelon. Yeah, it doesn't make any sense. But DC said, you know, we have a thing where we need to really get new people reading because the movies are not doing it. They get people interested, but they don't buy the comics. So we're hoping with Walmart, it's $5 for 100 pages, and we're hoping with Walmart, the moms and the dads are right there. If you want to know where they are in Walmart, there's a section right in the front of the store where you self-check out, and then there's this wall of cards and collectibles. It's right in there. Because people keep going to the books or they keep going to a section in the back, and that's not where they are. They're smack in the front. This little box that has the four books in them, and what I've heard lately is now they're completely stocking them. When they did the first two, they only printed like a certain amount. And third issue on, they have a ton of them. So if you haven't seen them, check them out. They're great to give people who don't read comics. You know, because that's our job is to get people to read.
So that's a good point. So like, what was the first comics you both got into? Like, what was the first comics you both remember?
Amanda.
Like, pulled you into like, oh wow, this is comics.
Right. I mean, I really started out with Mad Magazine. That was like my first. That was like my first tooth that I lost. The tooth fairy gave me a nickel and a Mad Magazine, and so that got me hooked on, you know, comic style reading. And then when I would get sick and have to stay home from school, my mom needed me to just stay put in bed, so she would buy me Archies, a lot of Archies. So that's sort of what, you know, Mad Magazine and Archies is what got me hooked.
Yeah, I love Superman comics, but Archies were everywhere. For some reason, when I was a kid, there were Archie comics everywhere.
Yeah.
And then I discovered Superman and Fantastic Four. For some reason, those two books. And then eventually, my older brother had Playboys in his drawer, and that had a little Annie Fanny in the back. And that was a comic strip by a little elder. It was great. But once I discovered that in comics, and it was probably like 8 or 9 years old, and then I started like cutting people's lawns and doing all this stuff because there was a used bookstore near my house that had a section of comics, and they were 10 for a dollar. And they had now, so this is, again, I'm gonna give my age, so this is the early 70s, right? And the comics were from the 50s and the 60s in the 10 for a dollar comic. Now, you know, if I can go back in time, I'd be a rich man. But I used to go and buy 10 books and like random anything, I'd try everything. And it was the coolest time in the world. So much so, I'll give you a real quick story. The Salvation Army near my house, had, you can buy comics by the pound. And they were like, I don't know, maybe a buck for a pound or maybe a buck for 2 pounds. I don't know. It was a big stack like this and they would wrap them in rope. And I told the guy, if you don't put the rope around it and put them in cardboard boxes, I'll buy them all as you get them in. So we had a deal going and I would pick up a box for like $2, had like 150 books in it. And then I would sell them to my friends. Like I would put them in bags. I would, this when bags started, I put them in bags and I'd sell them. What do you need? You need Daredevil 12? There you go. That's $4. You know? I was hustling comics. Growing up in Brooklyn, you have to hustle something. When it snowed, me and my brothers, or three brothers, we'd go out and shovel snow for money, right? And then after we did all the old people on the block, because my parents made us do anybody that was older, we had to shovel their houses first before we can ask for money for other people. So we grew up the right way, you know. But I hustled, later on I hustled fireworks, and later on I hustled illegal VHS and Betamax tapes, and later on I hustled. It was just a life of hustling, but legitimately made money later on. But anyway, that's how comics started.
Like bootlegging VHS.
It's a great story for another con. And this is on it, so this is going to be on that DC Direct.
Yeah, the guys, DC Universe streaming service.
Universe streaming. Has anybody joined it yet?
Yeah, they've signed
okay.
up.
Okay.
Oh,
so this is coming on it eventually.
So they're doing a Harley animated series, kind of based on what Jimmy and I did.
And that's Amanda's art right there.
Yeah. So that was really fun. Actually, I had a really good time doing that art. So I can't see without my weight here. It's like it's either like
movie star.
Bright, fuzzy, or dark and sharp. There we go, okay. So yeah, I had a really good time. I mean, basically they were like, okay, we need a big widescreen picture of Harley and she's trying to like get everybody, you know, rallied up in the bar. So it's gonna be a little bit,
different than normal.
It's, well, I mean, it's also, I think it's like somewhere between PG-13 and R, I think it's gonna be like a little edgy.
It's a little edgy.
And, what's that?
That's
Bernie.
There's Bernie.
There is Bernie. Right?
he's your favorite
beaver. Yes. That's Beaver.
Although Mike the Cock isn't in there. I don't think Mike is.
They asked for Big Tony and...
Vulture.
That is, that's actually...
Pooch.
No, there's, No, it's a super villain trio. I can't think of their names, but they're like... It's a fox, a vulture, and a...
Anybody know who that is?
Something, I can't remember, but yeah, I can't remember the name. It's like a trio of animal villains, and I can't think of the name of them. But yeah, it's like all these like D-list villains, and Harley's like trying to rally everybody, and you know, I think it should be fun. I can't wait to see what they do with it. So they got me to do some character designs and some.
That's our only participation.
Yeah.
They didn't ask us to write it. They didn't ask us to do anything else. They just had Amanda do some drawings in it for it, you know.
But it's something fun.
It would have been smart if they hired us to write something.
Yeah.
When does that start?
I think
the fall.
This fall.
Oh, so you don't know any of the stories ahead of time or anything?
No.
They didn't involve us.
I mean, they give me a synopsis, you know, like sort of a loose synopsis about what, you know, like Harley and Ivy, you know, apartment hunting or something like that, you know.
Based it on a lot of our stuff.
Yeah.
Well, that's
like
what I was going to ask. If they
once again, they don't ask us. A side note, Suicide Squad movie. You had a question, that's okay. I saw your wife slap it down, but it's okay, it's all right.
It's actually along the same thing. If y'all had the option of choosing any DC character of your own choice, who would it be, and what would the premise behind it be?
I kind of know that already, right? I know what you're going to say. Should I guess?
You can guess, yeah.
Power Girl?
Well, always Power Girl.
Okay.
I would like to do like a Power Girl, Big Barda team up. That would be fun. I like Big Barda.
I'd like to draw anything with Batman's privates. The Batarang. What was the other name?
Bat-Nana.
What was the... How ridiculous.
I think
it's ridiculous.
Go us with those bat condoms.
Bat condoms.
Yeah, they got a little black batteries on the top.
Oh, batteries on the top. The internet's funny. We just turned it on the other day, and all of a sudden, that ends.
Well, that's the actual.
Privates,
that's the actual Dick Grayson.
Dick Grayson. Yeah, I don't know. It's,
I know why I saw the. Somebody on Twitter posted the actual art.
Anybody wants to see it?
It was the last one upstairs.
Oh, no, it's
so.
You know when you grow up and you're an artist, you have to draw nude models. And you have to, it has no. Who cares?
Yeah.
And you realize the rest of the world would rather their kids see a guy's head explode from a bus than an actual nudity. And you're like, something's wrong here. You know, it's like it's just something really twisted about it.
I used to own a comic book store in New Jersey. It's still there. I remember a guy was telling me, he's like, oh, I don't mind if my little girl, he brought in his little girl, she's like 6 or 7. I don't mind if she sees, you know, like blood and gore and everything, but I don't want her to see any boobies. And I was like, really?
I mean, I got a world of surprise coming to you, buddy.
Yeah, I mean, I guess take the mirrors out of the house. You know, what are you going to do?
Exactly.
I don't get it, but I never will. So I definitely have a European sensibility. Sex is fine. Nudity's fine. Violence, I'm not too crazy about. And even in the comics, when we do violence, it's usually over the top because I don't really, too realistic, it's kind of, that's dark.
Yeah.
And I don't know, I feel like you read comics, you want to get somewhere else. If you want to watch dark, just turn on the news. It's pretty dark.
It's the Hitchcock thing. What happens off screen is a lot scarier than the show.
I do prefer that. Even with horror, I kind of like, the stuff that scares me is the stuff I can't see so much, but my brain
that's
is filling in everything.
That's why Jaws is so successful.
Yeah, Joe, speaking of sharks, Amanda's
sharks
joke.
Oh.
You want to tell that joke again?
But yeah, I mean, John, that was like the happiest, that was, I guess, what's his name we call a happy accident, is they couldn't get the mechanical shark to work, so they had to like sort of hide the shark, and it actually ended up being more scary, because you couldn't see it, you know, you knew it was there, but you couldn't see
so
it.
So you're saying Batman's privates were more scary when you couldn't see them?
Well, I mean, just like a little bit of shading here and there, so you're like, what is that?
Anyway, talk about your
Oh yeah. So Invicta decided to do a Harley Quinn watch, and that's like the next big ticket item, I guess, the next big ticket Harley thing that's coming out from Invicta, and they're launching it at New York Comic Con. I don't know how many guys are going to go up to New York for the comic book convention.
Well, so Amanda did the piece on the right. It's
it's from that cover, the Harley 31 cover, I guess.
No, that's an original piece right there, though.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Oh, that one, yeah.
That's how it works at home.
The watch.
I did that? Yes, you did that.
She's got the watch fake, the fake.
Oh, no, the watch is from the comic, but the art on the right.
They have to do they're going to have like a giveaway, a poster where.
It's a print.
11 by 17.
It's 11. It's everybody who goes to New York Con, if they go to the Invicta booth, they get a free print.
Yes.
Which is kind of cool.
Signed by you.
Yeah.
Signed by, and we'll sign it. And then if you buy the watch, you get a certain amount of books, and then Amanda will sign the watch box and even the watch. The back of the watch has a signature on it in metal.
It's not going to be easy.
We'll figure it out. But they're selling them at New York Con for a certain price, and during the con, I think there's like an Invicta channel or something. There's some cable channel that you can buy it, and it'll be available afterwards through Invicta. I think there's 3,000 they made.
Yeah,
so
3,000.
So 3,000. Yeah. That's kind of neat. We just it was kind of a cool thing to do.
Yeah.
And we get a free watch out of it. So there you go.
And we have one if you guys stop by the table.
It weighs like 80 pounds, so you can.
Yeah, Invicta watches, if you know anything about Invicta watches, they're very heavy. If you have, like, if somebody attacks you in an alley, you can just brain them with the watch, and it'll work, I'm telling you.
Okay. There goes that sponsorship.
Where
right out the window. Like, enjoy this, because this will be the last of Amanda Khanna and Invicta watch. He's just pushing them as a weapon.
Somebody with it last night.
Could you kill a shark with one? All right.
Just some of the
details. All right, just real quickly, Painkiller Jane, we're bringing the book back next year. But right now, we're at the final stage of going over the screenplay with Jessica Chastain. Jessica's going to play Painkiller Jane, and her production company, Freckle Films, is actually doing the film, so it's a mostly female production, which is kind of cool. And they based it on a story that I wrote, and yeah, so hopefully next year we'll see that go into production and eventually have a Painkiller Jane film with Jessica Chastain. The pro is at Paramount Films. We read the screenplay. It's just as disturbing as the comic.
How many people have read the pro?
Anybody read the pro? Okay, if you haven't read the pro, we have some at the booth. It is, we put it out in 2001.
It's amazing.
It's 2002? Okay. And it's written by Garth Ennis and drawn by Amanda and I, and we put it together. It's the first superhero prostitute. It is not for kids. The book is an adult book. It's in its seventh printing. It's one of our best-selling books we've ever done. It is, though, it is the filthy Watchmen, we call it. It just keeps getting reprinted.
Like selling and reprinting.
It's also, as somebody told me in New York that doesn't buy comics, he says, this is the book we hand out at parties to people. And they go home and read it and go, oh my God, what the hell, and pass it to the next person. So if you haven't read it, the guys who have understand that, the people who have, right, understand it's like nothing you've seen before.
So for everybody that rose their, you know, put their hand up, that you laughed at stuff, people that don't laugh, that this is the book
this
for you.
One.
This
yeah.
is the book that would get everything you're doing.
Yeah, you don't want your mom to read it. Well, your mom has a good sense of humor.
My mom loves it.
Yeah, your mom. That's the endorsement. Yeah. Amanda's mother loves this book. That's going to be on the next print thing, right?
She actually said, she said, I just love her. She's such a great character.
Do you put new material in each printing?
Just a new cover.
Yeah, I wish. People get mad sometimes when you do that. They're like,
I
don't want this issue. Why, you know, I don't know. It's a weird thing to mess with something.
Yeah, we started, you know? Garth wrote an extra backup story after, I think, like the fourth printing or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah,
the hoe.
The pro versus the hoe.
Oh, yeah.
Because her and an actual prostitute go at it. But anyway, you just have to check out the book. If you haven't picked it up, we have them at the booth. Random Acts of Violence is a movie. Justin and I wrote this book years ago, and then Jay Baruchel, if you guys don't know who he is, he's, you know, from the voice of the kid from How to Train Your Dragon.
Yeah.
But he's in a million Seth Rogen films. And so
Have
Jay.
You saw him, you'd be like, oh, that guy. Yeah.
Yeah, you know him if you saw him.
This is the End with Seth Rogen. The Goon movie with the hockey movie.
The hockey movies, you haven't seen
that.
Any
yeah, that's Jay Baruchel. He's side.
So Jay bought the rights. Jay, we were in Toronto like a month and a half ago, and we were there for the first 2 days of shooting the movie. They just finished production, so it's all shot. It's with Jordana Brewster, Jay, and who's the kid from Grey's Anatomy?
The handsome guy.
Williams?
No.
Grey's Anatomy is a real handsome guy. Williams.
Pretty eyes.
Pretty eyes. Amanda keeps reminding me he has pretty eyes.
But not as pretty.
They just finished production, so it's shot. We're looking at the beginning of next year, probably, for it to hit theaters. So how cool is that?
Cool.
And we got to meet them and hang out.
Yeah.
They didn't kick us off set.
So before we go any farther, does anybody have any questions? We can go ahead. The rest of the slides we can go through as we have.
Yeah.
If people got questions, we want to make
I got a question. Are you guys filming this? So what do? You watch it later?
Yeah. We post it.
You post it? Right, that's cool. What's your, is it a YouTube channel?
Facebook.
What is your Facebook so people can look at
it?
It's Criticologos. Actually, if you want, we can spell it for you later.
Okay, sounds good.
Yeah, you can go in.
If you're on Facebook, we have a Paper Films page. Just tag
us
on it.
Tag us
we'll be happy to retweet it and repost it.
We'll get at least seven more people looking at it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
This is very good. Hey, you know, that's
seven. It's
seven,
not
man.
Something.
It's a good number.
Better
Why
than
not
zero.
You're
Why
not
eight?
For eight?
Look at our audience. Do we really?
Amanda's been for at least eight.
Amanda will watch it eight times.
You're bringing it again.
You guys don't want to watch this again. Why would you want to watch that again? If you turn the cameras on them, then they can go, oh, look, there's me. And then you got my 12.
Right now you're live.
That number nine.
You're live.
There you go. Okay.
And record.
All right.
So we have
yes.
Time.
Yeah. Yes, a question all the way in the back, the wise guy.
Do you guys got a? Do you guys have a favorite artist here at the show?
I was gonna say Amanda Connor, but that's too easy. Plus, I need to.
Actually, I
gotta
look at the guests. I haven't like really been walking around. I have to look at the guest list.
I know Steve Rude. I'm a big Steve Rude fan.
That's right. I talked to Steve yesterday.
The
He's
dude,
good.
John Boy's good.
Yeah.
There's a lot.
Yeah.
Corin is, who else? Oh, yeah. I can't think of anything. You know, it's an odd show because it has a lot of, you know, you walk around and you see people you've never seen before and you're like, oh, that guy's fantastic. Why isn't he doing more books? It also is an odd thing because if you guys notice this, the artist alley, there's not really artists that draw the insides of books. They only draw pinups of the Deadpool and Harley, and there's a lot of that. You know why? Because you got to be a tough guy to draw the inside of a comic. That's like a lot of work. Right, Amanda?
That's right, baby.
You got to be a tough guy. Yeah, it's not just drawing about that guy going like this. You have to actually draw people in cars.
Chairs. Chairs are a pain in the neck. Chairs and rocks. I hate drawing chairs and rocks.
Rocks are so easy. I don't get it. You love rocks, too.
I collect rocks.
She does. She collects
rocks. You know, but I can't draw them. Maybe that's why I like them so much, because they're so, like, elusive.
The elusive rocks. Where did you find rocks, people? Where did you get them? We did a three-week trip in a car, and we went from Salt Lake City all the way up to Wyoming to...
And you know what I bought?
She bought rocks. She had a bag of rocks in her suitcase. Kind of cool ones, though.
And now you can say, geez, what's in here, rocks? And I can say, yes, there are rocks.
Charlie Brown. I got rocks. So any other questions? Anything? Yes?
I know there's not too much time in your line of business to do other things, but what are their like hobbies or interests you guys do outside?
Collecting rocks.
Do you put them in your collection of shoes?
I collect shoes too.
It's like a centipede, my wife. She's like a thousand shoes. I'm like, what are you growing those legs? And you can put them all on. And she loves her shoes. You love to mail order shoes.
I mean that's the thing is because you can't always, you know, find what you're looking for in the store, or you don't have time to go looking in the store. So it's like Zappos, you know, or Amazon. But and then you can like order extras and try it on, and the ones that fit you keep, and then the ones that don't fit you just send back.
Man, this carbon footprint is gigantic.
I know, I feel really bad about
and it. And it's shaped in the size of like a fancy shoe.
Carbon
footprint's in a fancy.
Looks like an actual footprint.
Right.
We used to go to movies.
Yeah, we go to movies a lot.
Yeah.
Although we haven't gone lately, and the last
you know
movie
what?
We saw was about a giant
so
shark. That was not very good. Did anybody see that? Meg?
Meg.
It was, okay. Maybe.
I don't feel like it was a waste of 2 hours. I enjoyed it.
Okay, so if you didn't see the movie, I'm not going to ruin it for you. It's about a giant shark that eats people, okay? I ruined it for you. But not enough. But for me, not enough people. So this giant shark's a shark the size of this building. It's in China. It goes by a beach. Who saw it? Just a show of hands. So you guys know what I'm talking about. And the beach scene has millions of people. And the shark doesn't eat them. He kind of goes there and grabs a raft and pulls the people on the raft. And I'm like, they missed the greatest scene in the world. Is the shark just turning sideways and eating like hundreds of people? And then him going out to sea, and then all of a sudden, who was the main guy in it?
Jason Statham.
All of a sudden, somebody says, oh my God, it's coming back. And Jason Statham says, well, you know, it's Chinese, so. He's hungry still. Nobody gets that joke. That's such a New York joke. I don't understand. Okay, I have to explain that. In New York, you eat Chinese food, and everybody says you're hungry an hour later, and that's so anyway. Did you guys like Meg?
It was okay.
It wasn't a complete waste of time because
That's a great review. This was not a complete waste of time. Let me look under the word complete and then put, oh, this movie was complete.
Unlike the Transformers movies, this wasn't a complete waste of time.
Right.
I laughed a lot.
Yeah, I did too. I laughed a lot.
I wanted just more. If you have a shark that big, didn't you think they would jump up and grab a helicopter at some point?
Yeah, that was very disappointing.
That was disappointing.
Yeah, I thought we would. I think what is this, the tornado, Sharknado's kind of ruined it for us. You know, because they have a tornado with sharks in it. That's pretty. I went to a Sharknado party. I'm going to tell you what it is to be famous in comics, okay? I got invited to the Sharknado party in San Diego. And it's like in this hotel with a pool. And all it was, they blew up a bunch of inflatable sharks and threw them in a pool. And they said, hey, free drinks. That was the whole party. That was the Sharknado. That's what is being famous in Hollywood. That was my Hollywood party. It was disappointing.
Did they at least put red food dye in the
Nope.
Really?
No. They just had blow-up sharks.
Yeah.
And I'm like, can I take one? And they're like, no. And I'm like, well, you have like 100 in there. Like, that's like teasing you. Like, you can't have one. Anyway.
You want to share like your favorite videos you like to waste time on as a hobby?
Oh, we watch great videos last night.
No, you heard.
Oh, hobby. Oh, man. Yes. Here we go.
My hobby is finding like animals doing really funny stuff. And lately it's been hamsters on wheels. Because sometimes, like, if you get two hamsters on a wheel, there's always going to be one that's faster than the other one. So there's one that goes really, really fast, and the other one just goes like that. that and what else were we watching? Yeah, anything where people. I love watching people wearing GoPros and falling, because you always see feet and then a shoe flying off the distance. So that's a hobby of mine. Not very active. I'm not active. I need to hike more.
The other night we watched a bunch of videos from Di Antwood.
Di Antwood,
do you know that? Oh my God.
Yes, they're crazy.
Oh my,
they're fascinating to
they're
watch.
They're a South African guy and girl that do videos and put out albums, and they were in the movie Chappie, if you ever saw Chappie, they were in it, but you've never seen videos like this. That's all I'm gonna say. Just look it up and watch them. They're not for the kids, but they're super creative and super cool. But I also collect comic art, but I've calmed down with it because like now I know a lot of the artists, and you can't really ask them for art because they just give it to you, and then you feel guilty because you're taking money away from them. So I don't ask anybody for art. I go buy it online with everybody else because I don't want to put them on a position. But I collect it through the years. Just can't afford most of it anymore. It's really expensive, you know?
It is.
Yeah.
Anybody
else? Comic book related questions or nothing?
Or non-comic book related questions?
Yes.
Actually, okay, so this is comic book related. I'm going to fill this too, actually.
Okay.
For my podcast. So, what do you think is attributing to the shift in comic perception? At one point in time, comics were considered, I can line my birdcage with it, but now it's kind of shifted. The pendulum has shifted a little bit. Comic artists and writers are taking center stage, and they've become more of a fixture than they used to be. What do you attribute to that?
It's funny because in the 30 plus years that I've been going to conventions, when I first started in comics, they were still sort of thought of as, kids, they like illiterate kids, they had a really, really bad reputation, even though people who read comics tend to like have a really, really good vocabulary and are really smart.
That am right.
but I remember, going into like having to make copies before I sent my artwork out, and there was like a lady in her 50s, same age as I am now, like, what is that you're drawing? And I'm like, oh, it's for comic books. I knew comic books. She's like, oh. She was looking at me like I had like a skunk smell coming off of me. And now it's completely different. I mean, also conventions. It used to be that it was only boys coming to conventions. The only time you saw girls was when they were like lugging comic books for their son, dad, brother, it was always like a family member. Being the burrow for the person getting their comics signed, and which was great for it because there was never any lines in the ladies' room. But now it's like almost 50% girls, So I think they've gained a lot more respect because of that and because of the movie. they used to be. You know, it used to be, my mom threw that out. And now they're like, oh my God, I have this great comic. So, you know, what do you think?
I think it took a little work to get here. Guys like Kevin Smith, featuring comics in their movies and going on TV and talking about his love for comics. Anytime we have somebody like that, even the idea that Nick Cage had a giant comic collection, and people are like, what, you know? I think it's slowly got legitimized as an art form. And I'll tell you guys, when we do a convention here in the States, and then we do one in Europe, they, for us, like, they treat us like superstars. They're like, you know, it's a whole different experience, you know? And again, a lot of the arts, like jazz, had to go overseas and then come back here to be appreciated. And it's just an interesting thing, because I think over the years, people started to see it for the art, you know, and guys like Andy Warhol and Lichtenstein, and, you know, it's putting comic art into a different space. Also, when you have these filmmakers are saying they grew up reading these comics and everything, it just, all of that helps. The other thing is, it's funny, when we did Marvel Knights, Joe Quesada and I did Marvel Knights, which was 20 years ago, in 98, we decided that we needed to be the face of the comics we were doing. So Joe and I did TV shows pushing the Marvel Knights line. Now it's not so abstract, but back then it was really abstract. We did TV, we made sure our faces were on a thing. We even went to Wizard Magazine and said, you know, if you're gonna do an article on us, you have to show us who we are. Because I felt at the time, and I still think comics should have photo credits. All my paper film stuff has photo credits. I think people like to see who's doing their books. I think they like to see them visually. I think they like, you guys are sitting here listening to us ramble on, but it's a connection, right? It's a connection. We get to hang out with you guys, and we get a lot of feedback from what we do. And I just think it's become more interactive, and the internet helps that. Even though a lot of crazy people are fighting on the internet, there's still a lot of great stuff. I'm on Twitter, but I don't get into that craziness too much. I'm like I'm the guy that steps in and goes, hey, everybody chill out and let's go get some pizza or something. It's very Italian, I know. Patrick, just saying. And I think all of this helped. And I think comics, you know, now we even have a Hollywood Reporter, they make movies out of them. Remember when I started, there were no comic movies, or it was just Superman. And then we had a Batman.
They tried to make comic book movies, but they were huge.
I think CGI really helped comics movies big time. So much so it's almost overdone to me. It's almost like I want them to pull back a little bit. Did anybody see the clip on the internet yesterday of the new Joker?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yeah. You guys see that? Who's the actor?
Yeah.
Joaquin Phoenix, right. And, you know, people are like, oh, I hate it, and this and that. I thought it was pretty cool.
He would be perfect for the Joker. I mean, me personally, I think he would be perfect for it, because he's so nuts.
But I do remember when they announced the last Joker, not the one from Suicide Squad, the Heath Ledger.
Mm-hmm.
I remember when they showed Heath Ledger as a Joker, everyone hated it.
Mm-hmm.
I remember that. And then I think he's one of the best. He was fantastic. But that little interaction, you look how many retweets and how many people looking at it and commenting, shows you how much things have changed about superheroes. You know, people had no opinion of it, now have tons of opinions. And again, movies like Guardians, which I think are unbelievable. I love the Guardians movies and stuff like that. So it's taking a long time to legitimize. And again, at the same time, we take a lot of step backwards because we have less readers than ever. But I think that's a reflection on people reading less, and not so much on comics, you know, so it's up to the parents in the room to kind of keep the kids reading. But it's tough to read when you have a game, a video games. They didn't exist back then. You know, comics were created when we didn't have 1,000 TV channels, video games. We didn't have all this other stuff. It was just, I remember, when I was a kid, me and my friends would sit on my stoop, which is the front of the house, the stairs. So you know, Patrick, you're looking at me.
Is that an Italian?
It's an Italian thing, in Brooklyn thing.
It's a concrete front porch.
And we'd be six of us, and we'd have stacks of comics, and we'd be sitting out there for hours. And my mom used to come out and bring us some stuff to eat, you know, treats. But we'd be sitting there reading and comparing the books and saying, oh, this is a good one. And, you know, because it was a different world. So comics have to change. We have to get comics to new people. Maybe you have to show Batman's junk. I don't know what it is, but you have to kind of go out there. They change. But I think it's, now it's in the public's eye. It used to be when we said we do comics, like about, like when I was single, I went to a girl and said, what do you do? I said, do comics. I might as well have just said I'm a puppeteer, you know, or I'm a ventriloquist or something. Because they'd be like, oh, that's great. My friend is, I have to go. Right? And now you say you do comics, people are like, really? What comics? You know, how many places do we go with?
Yeah.
We say, oh, we work on a character called Harley Quinn, and they're like, eyes light up. And they go, Harley Quinn.
You know my character? Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I hate you. Anyway.
Well, and that ties, because has everybody, Big Bang Theory?
I feel like Big Bang Theory was very, very
cool.
You have creators that are on that show that personally are fans of the you guys' work. So.
Sheldon's chair. You sat in his
chair. I sat in his couch spot.
She did. She got.
I did.
The guys that create the show are huge comic fans, so when we went out there.
You can tell because they know they were comic stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and in fact, one of the guys on the show used to work at Jim Hanley's Universe in New York.
Comic store in
Stewart. Yeah.
He actually used to work at a comic store I used to
like
go to. So he actually is legit.
Yeah.
And but we went on a set, they invited us on a set, we watched them do a read through, and then we got to sit on their furniture. We got to sit in Sheldon's, and we went to
Penny's
bar, apartment.
You know, like her
like island
where
she was. It's so geeky, but it was so much fun.
It was.
You guys understand
and
it.
I feel like the big, I know a lot of people, like there's like hardcore comic book people that are like, that's not real comic book fans, and I'm like, well, maybe next time. Yeah, maybe next time they'll be able to, now that they've done Big Bang Theory, they can do the Eltingville comic book horror science fiction. Yes.
It's an Evan Dorkin comic.
That's like real comic book fans. I feel like Big Bang Theory has done wonders for people, for like actual comic book people, like kids who love comic books in high school are getting less wedgies now because they're more understood. That's what I think.
What's wrong
not wedgies.
Patrick Wedgie. That's your new name, Patrick Wedgie. No, it's definitely used to be like the not cool thing. Now it's like, look, nerd. I don't like the word nerd because I think nerd is, I just don't like using it.
They
own it.
Yeah.
Did anybody see the episode where they opened the new comic store and they were joking about the poster that was on the wall?
Yeah, he was like, how do I get more girls into to comics? And Amy Penny and Bernadette were all sitting around going, well, maybe if you didn't have a girl in chains like a dog. Yeah, I got to do that poster. That was awesome. So that's one of my very fulfilling accomplishments, is posters
very cool.
For Big Bang Theory.
And Sheldon, you did Young Sheldon, you did a couple.
Oh, I did three comic book panels for Young Sheldon when he was like trying to be brave and eat a red bun. You know? He wouldn't eat any solid foods. So.
Long story, I have to watch him.
Yeah.
So we have a website called paperfilms.com. If you go on it, a little thing pops up. It asks you to join our newsletter, and Patrick puts it together. And it's like, so he'll take photos even of you guys here. Did you take one?
Yep.
Okay. And we post photos. So after every show, we post photos, and then we do things like, here's where we're going to be next, and here's some artwork you haven't seen by Amanda, and here's some embarrassing photos that we don't want anybody else but you to see. So it's free to join. You get it in the email, and if you hate it, you can always cancel it. It's not like, you know, some of the other emails that you get that you keep filling out your name and then canceling it and then getting it 3 weeks later. I don't know if you do that. I cancel stuff every week, and it keeps coming back. But anyway, I want to thank you guys for coming. Appreciate you spending time with us. And please come by the booth and see us.